Okay. Good morning, everybody. How are you today? Are you ready for another day of STEM? Say yes. You are in for a tremendous treat. And I want to introduce our first speaker for today. So students, ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests, and fellow enthusiasts of the intersection of art and science, it is both an honor and pleasure to introduce our esteemed speaker for today, who will shed light on the intriguing and increasingly relevant topic, putting the arts in STEM. In a world that constantly evolves through technology and scientific achievements, we sometimes find ourselves immersed in things technical, in things analytic, forgetting the importance of creativity, expression, and the human touch. Today, we are fortunate to have an advocate for the integration of art into the realm of STEM, science, technology, engineering, and mathematics, who will explore the compelling idea that art and science are not opposing forces, but they come together, they integrate in ways that make life so much more interesting. And so our speaker will explore the compelling idea that you bring together the art and the science in a harmonious way that is going to drive innovation and is cultivate what we all want, that is well-rounded individuals that will shape our collective future. The arts and the science together, she is sure to insist, will enhance our understanding of science, making complex ideas more accessible and stimulating our imaginations. So we could find no better presenter to delve into the myriad ways in which art enhances STEM education, fosters innovation, and nurtures the human spirit, and encourages us to think outside the box, inspire breakthroughs in scientific research, and redefine the boundaries of possibility than one of UCCI's most known and loved professors, Dr. Erica Gordon. Dr. Gordon has been a trained teacher of English and Spanish since 1989. She has taught at the high school, college, and university levels. Dr. Gordon holds a first degree in mass communications, that is print journalism, and a Master of Philosophy degree in English Literature from the University of West Indies, Mona. She then went on to do a PhD in curriculum development, and she completed this program with the University of London School of Education. Dr. Erica has served as chair of the Department of Arts and Humanities. She currently teaches Spanish and English courses at UCCI, where she is currently an assistant professor. And so, by the end of this presentation, I am confident that we will all gain a deeper appreciation of the power of integrating the arts into STEM and the profound impact it can have on our lives and the world at large. So without further ado, I invite us all to join me in welcoming our distinguished speaker who will guide us on our journey through the world of putting the arts in STEM. Please help me welcome Dr. Erica Gordon.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Dr. Liv. And thanks to the organizers for including me in this STEM conference. Dr. Liv, you should have told me about that introduction so that I make sure to do what you said I'm going to do. I might disappoint now because I prepared without knowing what you were going to say, but let's see how it goes. So, about 25 years ago, one of my friends and classmates in the MPhil PhD program at UWI Mona complained to me about her son's chemistry teacher. No, it wasn't Mrs. Gale. She had been going through her son's lab book and was shocked by a report. One sentence struck her and caused her to boil. You can imagine the steam coming from her ears and nostrils. The sentence: the liquid was brung to a boil. She was livid. As if that were not enough, the teacher had ticked it, given it approval. She was mad. She headed to the school and confronted the teacher. She was adamant that the arts, this time the language arts, should have a role in STEM and should not be ignored. Flash forward many years later, and you will agree with me that the debate about STEM and STEAM has gained traction in the last couple of years, with many persons who are proponents of the arts lobbying for their rightful place in STEM. STEM practitioners also advocate for the inclusion of the arts in science, technology, engineering, and math classrooms. We acknowledge that science and technology are driving many areas of life and relationships, and AI seems poised to replace humans. Please meet head teacher Abigail Bailey. She is the first AI robot who has been a principal head teacher at a school in England. I agree with Cole, who posits that without the arts, without aesthetics, STEM professionals would be hampered in their attempts to understand data and visualize patterns in their work. He concluded that moves to put the arts back into school is good news for science education. I firmly agree with my UWI colleague from yesteryear and many others who advocate for the inclusion of the arts in STEM. I am recommending that the arts be embedded in STEM for completion, for health and relaxation, for collaboration, for comprehension and facilitation, for aesthetic appreciation and manipulation, for communication, and to prevent economic stagnation. So what exactly do we mean when we speak of, advocate for, and insist on the inclusion of the arts in STEM? We believe that the arts help to develop creativity, communication, character, and help to fashion us for life. I draw on the categories established by Georgette Yackman, who was one of the early advocates for STEAM education. The arts is a broad field. They include the fine arts, painting, sculpture, photography, drawing. We also include the language arts, communication, foreign languages, literature, poetry, drama, prose, creative writing, and also sign language. The physical and performing arts, including sports, theater, dance, and music. The manual arts, physical skills, including ceramics, architecture, and landscape design. And the biggest area, the liberal arts, which include the social sciences, philosophy, psychology, ethics, sociology, politics, education, civics, theology, and history. Patterson, in presenting his 2021 report on the reform of education in Jamaica, made a case for the A in STEAM to be annals, highlighting the importance of history in STEAM education. I agree that this is seminal as ignorance of history can lead to many problems, destruction, and even loss of lives. Imagine with me what would happen if an engineer tasked with building a bridge or a road in rural Jamaica refused to listen to the advice of the old, uneducated men in the district who knew the pattern and activities of the river for ages. The engineer, armed with new ideas and technological tools, constructs his edifice, which gets washed away in the first major storm as the river reclaimed its course. This is the stem pyramid as advocated by Yakman. We can look at this later for further details. Marcus Garvey cautioned us, a people without the knowledge of their past history, origin, and culture is like a tree without roots. So history, very important, cannot be ignored. Consider what happened in New York on September 30, 2023.
Guys, look what I'm passing. This is Bronx River Parkway, right after you get off of the Mount Vernon exit. Look at it. Hey, bro, you shouldn't stop, man. You should just continue. Are these cars blocking there?
Man, stop right in front of me.
Oh, you shut off now? You shut off?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, because you stopped. You should just continue, bro.
The guy in front of me just stopped
there. Yeah, continue. Tell him to continue. No, this guy. Oh, wow, man. People get stuck. Look at this, man. Look at this. People turning in the road. Oh, my God. Look at that.
Do you think that those engineers considered the history of the place? Or do you agree with one of my colleagues from one of my UA WhatsApp group who supplied these fun facts about the whole area that flooding have a keep because they did not consider the history of the place? The arts are necessary in STEM for completion. What do I mean by including the arts for completion? The arts and sciences coexist and should be interdependent. The creativity, critical thinking, and collaboration that are inherent in the arts can facilitate comprehension, discovery, and innovation in the sciences. I noted carefully that our homegrown NASA scientist, Dr. Williams, highlighted the creative activities that she participated in as a child, which helped to foster her development. It is posited that looking at the world through artistic eyes generate new thoughts and ideas and new ways to look at the world. Can you also consider how the sciences and arts converged in the work of the ancient Mayans, Galileo, Copernicus, Leonardo da Vinci, and others who, through their artistic means, communicated new ways of understanding the world? I think all the scientists present know these artistic pieces and will agree with me that the arts are present. Can you imagine trying to grasp some abstract scientific concepts without the use of diagrams? Illustrations, models, and realia all help us to visualize and better understand what is taught in the scientific classroom. Think of biology, agricultural science, technical drawing, courses in nursing and medicine without the inclusion of the arts. Just learning about the chemical reactions and processes in theory and not being able to manually complete the tasks and see how they work? Yes, you get to bring your own liquid to a boil. From my high school days, from 1977 to 1984, I was, and I still am able to remember the order of the planets with the help of the language arts. Of course, we know that poor Pluto is no longer among them. We mourn the loss of Pluto. But Mary's violet eyes make John stay up nights proposing. That helped me to remember the order of the planets. Or consider what happened for me with math, trigonometry. Since 1982, I learned some officers have curly afro hair till old age. And that helped me to remember the formula for sine, cosine, and tangent. My colleague, Mr. Baker, told me that I am old and dated, as if I didn't know, and that the modern students use SOHCAHTOA to remember these same formulas. But what do I know? I didn't even pass maths. I do know, though, that the prefix tri in trigonometry is the same prefix as in triangle, meaning three, and that the formulae are used to work with triangles. Language arts to the rescue, full steam ahead. Additionally, in advocating for the arts in STEM, we realize that despite the view that some persons are left or right-brained, this theory has been drastically changed because scientists have realized that the whole brain perspective helps better with learning. So, in advocating this whole brain view, we suggest that activities drawing on a wide range of stimulation inevitably improve brain function, especially for higher order activity and critical thinking, as proposed by Braund and Reese, 2019. When left brain and right brain come together, the arts and the sciences work together, the result is undoubtedly better, more complete, and comprehensive. Without the arts, where would we find entertainment and relaxation? Certainly, every stressed out scientist could use a break to go to Wapnin, go on Instagram, join Sandra on Marl Road, watch a movie, listen to some music, watch CSI, Special Victims Units, or National Geographic. The scientists need the arts to help him or her, or to help them to chillax, regroup, and return to the serious life-changing projects, revived, reinvigorated, and ready to create more brilliant inventions. In fact, you would agree with me that the best medicine to assist with good mental health and healing is laughter. It has been proven scientifically that laughter helps the human body to relax, de-stress, unwind, and recalibrate to take on the challenges of life. The scientists will tell you about the endorphins, dopamine, serotonin, and enzymes. I will just say it makes you feel good to be able to release all the pent-up emotions and stress through the visual, physical, performing, and manual arts. We have many avenues open up for us to blow off steam. I'm sure that during the COVID pandemic, many persons resorted to the arts to prevent them from going crazy under lockdown. As a matter of fact, let us pause for some science-related humor. So I have a question. I don't know who can answer. I guess I have some prizes in my bag there. So we'll see if you can answer these questions, you might just get a prize. What would you call a Rastafarian optician or ophthalmologist? Anybody from Jamaica out there? Yes, somebody knows over there? Where are mics? Can somebody bring a mic so we can hear the answer? I see the hand, let's get the mic so we can hear. Or can you shout? a Rastafarian optician or ophthalmologist. And while we're thinking about that one and waiting for the answer, here's another to think about. Who was the fattest knight at King Arthur's table, and why was he so fat? You know that one? Okay. Too much what? It has to be scientific. Oh. Do we have the mic over there yet?
Yes, I think I finally figured out how to turn it on.
So you see, well, Dr. Ivan, I know you're from the arts, but you're in the scientific and the technical field.
That I'm learning every day, too.
Yes, Rastafarian ophthalmologist or optician?
Is it eye and eye or an eye or something like that?
Almost there. It's an eye doctor.
That was a good one.
Thank you. So who's telling me who was the fattest knight at King Arthur's table and why was he so fat? The math people? Circumference. Why? He had eaten too much pie.
You should have known that, Glenn.
Yeah, Glenn didn't know. All right, next question. I think I gave this one away earlier. What is the longest word in the English language? Smiles. There's a mile between the two S's. Or did you hear about the sheepdog who reported to his master that he had put all 100 sheep in the pen? The master said, But we only have 96 sheep. The sheepdog was a math pro. He said, I rounded them up. And who can explain why these persons are in prison? No, not you, Kabira, because you know. Mike over here.
Money laundering.
Okay, so yes, one is money laundering, and the other two? So please note who is my money launderer so we can get a prize. The other two, okay, Mike coming for the other two.
Did the battery commit battery?
And then what about the other one?
I don't know about the other
one. Somebody else then? Boy, these prizes are being split up too much.
Don't assault there? Committed assault?
Assault and battery, yes. Assault and battery. And how many of you have seen this video with a mathematician praying? I really love it. Maybe because I'm in the arts, but I can hear the math coming out. Let's hear about the math in this prayer.
When a math teacher prays,
subtract all negativity and add fraction of your blessings and multiply the blessings, oh God, because you can put it to whatever power you want to put it to. Shelter me in a bracket and bless my loved one simultaneously in the equation, oh God. We are equal, but some people feel like they are hypotenuse. But the root of evil shall not be my destruction. Simplify me, Lord. If I expand with hype, Lord, and make me whole, you sit above like a numerator, and I hope if I stray, oh Lord, from you, it will not be a long division. Keep me safe in your precious name, I pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. I am insisting that scientists who embrace the arts have an advantage over those who don't. In fact, and I quote, according to several studies, artistically inclined scientists tend to win more awards than their less diversified colleagues. Most Nobel Prize winners and members of the National Academy of Sciences have art-related hobbies. It is believed, end of quote, it is believed that exposure to music enhances the intellect. Ask Glenn Inanga about that. The observational and creative skills needed to be a successful artist, musician, poet, or creative writer are also crucial to being a successful scientist. Painting, piano playing, and poetry help to put things in context, sharpen details, and hone observation skills. They sort the essential from the peripheral, forge connections, find patterns, and discover new ways of seeing familiar things. These are exactly the tools that good scientists need. I propose that collaboration between the arts and STEM is necessary for success in STEM. Whereas it is true that not every project will use all the aspects of STEAM, where two or three categories converge, great things happen. Working together, the arts and sciences will produce the best results. There are various examples of real-life projects that successfully utilize STEAM to create useful items that make life easier. In tandem with this, consider also the aesthetic and utilitarian successes that are made possible via incorporating the creativity of the arts with STEM. Lighting, recliners, standing desks, mouse pads, mice, false teeth, dental implants, false nails, false hair, false butt, knee replacements, hip replacements, Invisalign instead of all the metal in the mouth of the tin grinners, or even the results of the braces, and prosthetic limbs that are made via 3D printing. Those of us who were at STEM camp had the privilege of creating our own keychains using 3D printing. The art and the sciences came together. Now, can you imagine how thrilled the recipients of new limbs are? Limbs that are now being made via 3D printing, crafted especially for the persons who will receive them. Check out this video with me.
So I co-founded OpenManics because we wanted to build assistive devices that could enable people to have more freedom and independence. And we wanted these devices to be really affordable. So at the moment there's this amazing bionic technology that exists, but it's out of reach of most patients because it's so expensive. We want to completely change that and make it really accessible and democratize a really helpful technology. So at the moment, everything is really exciting at OpenBionics because we're gearing up to launch. We've been trialing our bionic hands with children as young as 8. I think the coolest thing about this is that we've been working really closely with amputees. We're not just designing a solution for them, they're helping us design the solution. I think it's a really exciting time, and in the very near future, we're focusing on our launch of the first 3D printed bionic limb. The core thing about my job includes seeing people being fitted with bionic limbs for the first time, and that's a really big moment. So for young children, they often don't have access to these devices because they're not made small enough, or they're just too expensive so their parents can't afford to supply them with it, or the NHS can't afford to supply the patient with it. So seeing a young child being able to move fingers individually for the first time is really cool.
I affirm with Hertz, 2016, quote, that everyone, from software engineers and aerospace technicians to biotechnical engineers, professional mathematicians, and laboratory scientists knows that building great things and solving real problems requires a measure of creativity. Hertz points to the art created by her students in the form of classroom furniture and prototypes that they build in art and tech classes, functional designs that are used in the school. For this task, the students researched actual needs in their building, then developed their designs based on these real-world needs and their own creative flair, end of quote. In addition to the creativity that is inherent in the arts, advocates for STEAM point to the need for soft skills, which are fostered through the arts. It is believed that the development of soft skills will make individuals more marketable and adaptable and perform better in the workplace. Daniel Goleman, in his emotional intelligence theory, made a case for soft skills in his proposition. Quote, how we handle ourselves and each other, end of quote, are the new yardstick by which success at work is being measured. Additionally, personal qualities such as initiative and empathy, adaptability and persuasiveness, how we work in teams and leadership are skills that should accompany intellectual and technical abilities. These soft skills are acquired, nurtured, and developed via the arts. We also advocate for the arts in STEM to facilitate effective communication. Although the visual, manual, and creative arts are important, I propose that the language arts are fundamental and foundational. Imagine with me what would happen if an engineer creates a device that is to make our lives better, but he cannot communicate how it works to anyone, or he cannot explain his concept to an artist or to a manufacturer to create the prototype so that he can test its practicality. Or imagine, if you can, how scientists would communicate the findings from their research without the help of the language arts. Clearly, these findings are to be reported in various journals, magazines, and online platforms in correct grammatical and lexical forms. The liquid was brung to a boil will not be accepted or tolerated here. Yakman's rationale for the language arts is worth quoting and noting, so I'm quoting it in its entirety. The field of language arts is seen as universal to all other branches of knowledge, as without it, the ability to communicate is severely limited. The underlying argument for the inclusion of language arts in all other fields is that if you can't communicate effectively, then how can you prove your conceptions, understandings, designs, and ideas in any other field? Dr. Williams, our opening speaker, also pointed to the fact that reading and writing are critical to all disciplines of study. I noted, too, her use of the language arts to speak about her life as a journey, and her advice to us to dream, to learn to fly, and to utilize her nuggets of truth. Which student can identify the figures of speech that she used in those phrases? Which student? Figures of speech? Okay, my student is answering. And you better be right. Johanna is answering.
Who's answering?
Joanna.
A metaphor.
Oh, yes, you're right. Thank you. Metaphors are used. Journey, dream, nuggets, all metaphors. Thank you. And thank you for being right. I don't know what I would do if you were not. The language arts are especially crucial to ensure effective communication. Mastering grammar, expression, and vocabulary is critical for success. Consider, for example, the following. Give her her book is correct, but give him his book is incorrect unless it is Jamaican Creole. I have a prize for the student who can read this sentence correctly. Somebody, anybody? There are hands over there.
Hands over there, on the bleachers.
And there's a hand over here too.
The bandage was wound around the wound.
Correct. First time correct. Wonderful. In many cases, the same words can act as nouns or as verbs, and they have different meanings. And if used incorrectly, there are going to be problems with the sentences that are created. Think of those problems that occur with persons who do not communicate clearly, or who are frustrated by the complexities, nuances, and vagaries of the language. There's a story of the man who approached a lady at a bar. He sidled up to her and said, "May I join you?" I think she was an engineer. She looked him over coolly and said, "Am I falling apart?" Or consider the policeman who encountered a lady knitting while driving on the highway. He pulled up to her and said, "Pull over." She answered, "No, scarf," and kept driving. Then there's a story of the pastor who approached a man in his community and said, "You need to join the army of the Lord." The man responded, "I have already enlisted." The pastor said, "But I don't see you in church." The response, "I am in the secret service." Pun intended, and probably lost on some of us. Yes, it is important for scientists to be able to communicate effectively. There's also the story of this man who returned home from the doctor with a skipping rope in the bag with his medication. So his wife asked him about it. He said to her, "Doctor said I should take 3 pills tomorrow, then skip the next day, then take 3 more pills, then skip the other day." Clearly, the doctor didn't communicate effectively. A good grasp of the English language, or any language in which the scientist is communicating, is necessary for comprehension and facilitation. Life definitely flows smoother when we embrace the arts. I want to switch gears a bit. So now I am proposing that the steam has been rising for years. In fact, I am insisting that though unacknowledged in parts, the arts have always been in STEM. The creative element that is visible in STEM activities is definitely from the artistic side. All scientific creations utilize the arts. Creative, manual, fine arts, language arts, to bring the ideas that are envisioned to life. In the STEM classroom, we see educators providing the historical background to concepts being explored and using artistic and creative means, whether music, art, drama, videos, blogs, vlogs, or social media, to bring science to life. The arts are definitely present there. Various schools and universities have embarked on integrative projects to embed artistic activities in the teaching and learning of STEM subjects. In the medical school classroom, there are reports of efforts to expose students to the creative and visual arts to help them develop their observational and interactive skills to increase their awareness of patients' emotions, see beyond the presenting problem, understand their patients, and communicate effectively with them. In a 2006 study, Training the Clinical Eye and Mind, Using the Arts to Develop Medical Students' Observational and Pattern Recognition Skills, Shapiro, Rooker, and Beck found that, quote, in the arts-based conditions, students also develop skills in emotional recognition, cultivation of empathy, identification of story and narrative, and awareness of multiple perspectives, end of quote. The students' soft skills were positively impacted. The researchers concluded that incorporating the arts, various methods in teaching, quote, can bring greater texture to the process of teaching clinical medicine and help us see a more complete picture of the patient, end of quote. In addition to advocating for the arts for completion, relaxation, collaboration, communication, and comprehension, I also contend that the arts are essential to prevent economic stagnation and promote prosperity among STEM practitioners. In his address at the beginning of this conference, President Robertson spoke about the research that was conducted here in the Cayman Islands, which showed that it is the STEM professions that are needed more than ever. But, as I pointed out earlier, these STEM workers need the soft skills, the critical thinking, the human skills from the arts to create and develop them into the requisite versatile, dynamic, well-rounded 21st century workforce. The robots, the AI, cannot provide this. We need humans to develop these soft skills. We want STEM workers and creators to be equipped with the skills and abilities that the arts offer. Who wants to buy a product that is useful and life-changing if it is not aesthetically pleasing? Consider phones and their development. From the fridge, to the sliver, to the razor, to the BlackBerry, to flip phones, to bangers, to smartphones and iPhones, now in their 15th iteration. I'm going to show you a short video about the development of the phone, and I want you to deny the artistic elements that are present here. Deny at your peril.
It was 40 years ago that the first cell phone call was made. Before this, there were car phones. They functioned more like radios. But the first call from a handheld cell phone came in 1973. Who made it? This man, Martin Cooper, general manager of Motorola Communication Systems Division. Whom did he call? His chief competitor at Bell Labs. There weren't any other cell phones then, so he dialed through to a landline. Bell Labs had first proposed the idea of a cellular system in 1947 and was working to create the first network. When did cell phones hit the market? That wasn't until 1984. The Dynatac phone offered 30 minutes of talk time.
This is AC's guidance counselor at Bayside.
Zach Morris, the character from Saved by the Bell, was always getting in trouble with Principal Belding for using it at school. It also became a symbol of ostentatious luxury enjoyed by the likes of Gordon Gekko and Wall Street. What came next? Other models and manufacturers emerged. Then presidential candidate Bill Clinton used one during his 1992 campaign. The same year, the 2G network was introduced, allowing for text messaging. By 1999, Finland's Nokia was the leader in the market, selling 79 million mobile phones worldwide, a lead it kept until 2012. When did it get sleek? The Motorola Razr, introduced in 2004, broke through as the hot new clamshell or flip phone. The competition to make cell phones stylish was on. When did they get smart? The vast communication possibilities of cell phones beyond just gabbing became clear with the BlackBerry. It started out as a texting device in 1999, but became a souped-up cell phone in 2003, boasting of email and internet access. 4 years later, Steve Jobs introduced Apple's new iPhone, and the rest, as they say, is history. That's the short answer.
So, who likes Crocs? Anybody like these cowboy Crocs that were built for Croctober? I saw a meme yesterday with somebody receiving their new ones and the excitement that occasioned getting it ready for being put on. Some people say Crocs are ugly, but it is a booming economy, and the creativity that goes into building these Crocs is undeniable. So you might say you don't like them, but I'm going to invite you to look at some of them. I think I'm doing something wrong. I'm going to end slideshow, go to the Crocs. Yeah. Do you see any that you like? I have this one. Do you like the platform ones? I think I'll get this one. I had bought this one too. Okay, so people are scouting out which ones they'll ask their parents to buy? Yeah? Do you see the creativity? Do you see the artistic abilities that are here? We have to combine the arts with the sciences. Oh, Kabir insisted that I wear these ones. These are Crocs too. To make a case for, or a business case, for the use of the arts in the creativity and the production that can take place. And then I want to share with you what's happening through Cute Circuit. They have shown how we can use science and the arts to create fashion that is wearable, but which is exciting. They're making a lot of money from this. So let's see if I can show you what's happening with Cute Circuit. So Cute Circuit has a hug shirt. Anybody knows about this hug shirt? Does anybody know about the hug shirt? Somebody, anybody, the hug shirt? And there's also the sound shirt. Let's explore the video of the sound shirt first. Glenn.
Music should be for everyone. Introducing the Sound Shirt, a wearable device that enables the deaf to experience a concert through touch sensations. After 6 months of development, we put it to the test. This is how it works. Microphones all over the stage cover the different types of instruments. A software converts the sound into data and sends it to the shirt, where 16 vibration motors pulsate with the intensity of the music. For example, the bass on the stomach and the violins along the arms. Several deaf people tested the shirt, and their reactions speak for themselves. The Sound Shirt, now available at the Young Symphonic Orchestra of Hamburg.
The hug shirt is also very interesting because it allows persons to hug across distances. So somebody would have the app over there in Japan, you can send a hug to somebody here in Cayman. Plus, there's lots of other fashion that they have created. So the hug shirt. A little bit about the hug shirt.
There are lots of devices that are wearable devices. They're definitely not fashion.
I think when people get excited about wearable technology, they're really excited about something new. So Cute Circuit is the first fashion company to incorporate wearable technology as a critical component of their designs.
People have been waiting for the hug shirts for a long time. So we're premiering the new design for the hug shirts. So imagine you're in New York and your best friend is in Tokyo. You give yourself a hug and their shirt is gonna get warm and vibrate in the same area that you touched on your shirt. Well, this data goes Bluetooth in your cell phone and is transformed into the hug message. So it's a touch telecommunication over distance. And so this is like really embedding tactile sensors into the garment.
You know, when you think of other industries like entertainment or healthcare or transportation, all of these are revolutionized by technology. And so we're taking fashion and bringing it to the 21st century.
Yeah, there is no wires in the garments. We got like a factory to develop a ribbon for us that can conduct electricity and stay very soft and flexible in the garment. You just plug your little tiny battery to charge and then you snap it with little snap buttons into your garment. So everything is very flat and very comfortable. And this is really different than having something that is just a gadget strapped to your wrist. Mostly we are doing this because we really want to give people a way to express themselves, to be connected with people they love. And so we started out trying to make this garment that could hug people over distance. So it's not a user anymore, it's a wearer. And the body is gonna be the interface.
So the possibilities for creative collaboration are endless. Unlike the tragic results of the ignorant command to proceed full steam ahead with the Titanic, the command for us, lovers of the sciences and the arts, can result in innovative creations that will benefit mankind and result in economic prosperity, sustainability, and progress for all. How will you ensure that we move full steam ahead? I am willing to play my part. Are you? Can embracing the arts be the game changer we need to level up, as the theme of this conference says? Let us collaborate then for a better, brighter, and more integrated future. Full steam ahead.
Didn't we enjoy that? Dr. Erica, boy, I tell you, you had us laughing. You had us learning all together. And I think we leave fully agreed that the sciences must be merged with the arts. Thank you so much. Another round of applause for Dr. Erica, please. And by the way, Dr. Erica, I tell you, in her classes here at UCCA, she is a really popular teacher, and you can know why, right? One more applause again for her, Dr. Erica. Thank you so much. Now, you might have questions for Dr. Erica. We're going to entertain a few questions before we go to the breakout sessions. Any questions for her you want to ask based on what she has presented? Anybody? There you go, yep.
Have you liked your career as a teacher?
That's a loaded question. And the answer is yes and no. So yes, I love teaching. Yes, I love passing on information. Yes, I love helping to change the lives of individuals. But what I don't like is when students don't do well. That's the hard part. That's the painful part. Grading the papers and seeing that students are failing, or when students fail the courses. That's the painful part. But yes, I do like the career as a teacher.
What years do you teach, as in grade?
Did you say what areas?
No.
Years. Ooh. So I have been teaching since 1989 when I left Teachers College. So it's a long time, more than 30 years. What years?
His question was what grade?
What grades?
What level do you teach?
So I have taught from year 9, 10, 11. I've taught year 12, A-levels and 13, and I've taught at the college level and the university level. At church, I teach from the small ones all the way up.
Would you recommend being a teacher to anyone else?
Oh, Jesus. Yes, I would, but with a caveat that it's going to be a lot of work, you won't get a lot of money, but there's a lot of satisfaction in knowing that you're helping to mold lives and to pass on information.
What's the best way to become a scientist?
Oh, gee. Now that means I need to ask a scientist to answer. Any of the scientists in the STEM audience that can help to answer? Glenn is scientist and artist all in one. Glenn, would you like to help me out?
My recommendation is to remain curious. Keep asking questions and don't be scared of the answers you might find.
Thank you so much.
Another question?
No. Is there? Yes.
For teaching, what area do you specialize in?
Okay, I specialize in the languages. So at Teachers College, I studied English and Spanish. So the languages. But then again, we have a saying, good teacher teach anything. So you give me the subject, I'll study the material and teach it, except for math.
What was your favorite year to teach?
Ooh, I think my favorite year to teach in high school was the year 12 or 13, the A-levels, yes, because of the maturity that those students brought to the program and how they adapted to the hard work that had to be done.
What's the best way to become a teacher?
Okay, the best way to become a teacher is to make sure that you pass at least your 5 subjects, grades 1, 2, they take 3 as well, and then you apply to and go to Teachers College. You could come here at UCCI to do the teacher education program, and then you'll be certified to teach. Of course, others go on to major in specific subject areas in order to become more proficient. So you go on to university to do specialized training. That can happen as well.
Which subject do you teach?
Which subjects do I teach? I teach English and Spanish now. So I teach Spanish literature and translation. I teach Spanish language and culture. I teach introduction to Spanish, and I also teach college composition.
What is your favorite subject to teach?
My favorite subject to teach is English literature, because literature is life, and it helps us to explore people and how they operate in life.
How is it like being here at UCCI, or is it your first time?
Okay, I've been here at UCCI since 2007, and it's a mixed blessing. There are highs and there are lows. There are wonderful things and there are challenging things, but we go with the flow.
All right, last question.
Okay, last question. For others who have other questions, you could see me afterwards and we could talk.
Do you feel like you need anything to improve on?
Oh, always. Always there are things to improve on. So like my public speaking skills and my technical skills, yeah, I had to get help from Kabira, my daughter, with the PowerPoint, and Louis had to help me out this morning. We said it. Yes, there are many things that I can improve in. Thank you. Thank you all very much. And for those persons who won prizes, please come see me to get them. Thank you.
Thank you, thank you. That was indeed tremendous. Thank you, Dr. Erica. We're going to go now to our breakout sessions. So teachers, ambassadors, if you have any questions about those, you could go to the front desk. But we have gotten a really good start for the rest of the day. So let's now move quickly towards our breakout sessions. And thank you so much, everybody. Thanks again. We'll be right back.